Broadcasting from the far side of Enceladus, beaming in at the speed of light across the vast chasms of space, streaming directly into your brain, you're listening to episode 22 of the Spartacast League. I am Phelan, and joining us today, it's just Hims.
Hi.
Yeah. Hello there. It's been a rough fortnight for the left since our last episode. Emboldened by extreme rhetoric, the right has committed numerous terrorist attacks in the United States and pulled off an electoral win in Brazil for the far right. But before we dive into our main stories this week, the Trump administration has yet again attacked and dehumanized the Saga community through an action by the Department of Education and Health and Human Services to strip transgender people of their identity by refusing to recognize them.
The what community? What'd you say? The Saga community?
The Saga community. That is an alternative for the acronym LGBT. And it means...
How come you know that and I don't know that?
Well, I know it because Eno told us this on a previous episode and you forgot.
Oh, well.
So, shout out.
So wait,
shout out to Eno
something
if he's
about
listening.
This. Tell us what it means and I'll shout out.
Okay, so it means... Oh, God. Of course you would do this to me. Of course you would do this to me. I should have known that you were going to do this to me. You always put me on the spot. Saga means sexually and gender acceptance community. So that's what the Saga community is. And so it's just a more inclusive term than LGBT. So instead of tacking on a letter every time we want to add something, we just say Saga. It makes things a lot more simpler. And some people I've noticed are using that term a little bit more often. And I do thank Eno for sharing that little tidbit of information with us a few episodes ago, even if you forgot about it, Hims.
But that's good, because as time goes on, LGBT does seem really restrictive, and it really categorizes things that don't necessarily even fit the research.
Right. We're finding more and more about these various spectrums. Some of our information and our preconceived notions with labels just no longer fit. In regards to the actual story with the Trump administration, so Health and Human Services wants to redefine the definition of sex under Title IX, which bans discrimination based off of gender in education programs that receive government financial assistance.
So first off, the first question on everyone's mind should be, why does the government define sex? Why is the state supreme over something that just biologically exists? But beyond that, it's bad because while the state does have supremacy over biology, I mean, the state has, and you know, Marx and all of the affiliates and people who disagreed with him and people who did agree with him recognize that the state has supplanted religion. The people worship the state. Directives of our lives, what is biological, what is normal, comes from the state. So the state defining this out of existence is essentially saying trans people don't exist. Now, of course, trans people are going to exist, but how they won't be able to operate within the state, won't be able to live, it shoves them into a box, which is a box that LGBT SAGA people have existed in constantly at previous times in this country and in, quote, the West and in the East too. I mean, we can't forget that like China and the USSR didn't have great track records with that either, especially Cuba. This is definitely a cause for alarm and a call to activism, real activism, actual activism, not...
This is about marginalizing a vulnerable group of people. This is about them, like what you said exactly, using the state to express supremacy over a given group. In this particular case, what they're doing is they're basically saying that sex is going to be defined on what your birth certificate is, your genitalia, and if there's any question, like if you've altered yourself or whatever, they'll just go by what the genetic evidence says. But science has since moved on from those kind of perceptions as to how gender works and everything. And
times Trump has cared about
science. The times that Trump has, yeah, exactly. I mean, ask these people about global warming and you'll find out exactly how much they care about science. Essentially, what's going on here is, or essentially, they're just doing this so that they could deny them care, treat them as second-class citizens. So the whole bathroom argument, you know, with, hey, these men shouldn't be able to go into women's bathrooms, so they should use the men's bathroom. Like, they're not going to let them use men's bathroom. Let's get real. That's not what this is about. This is about denying them the bathrooms entirely.
And this is an attack on multiple fronts for them as well, because, but I'm going to guess that trans people don't even make up 1% of the U.S. population. So to yes. go after this not even 1% of the population, yeah. it is nothing but fodder to energize their base, which is consistently angry about anything gender.
You are correct. It's about 1% of the population or so. It may be a little bit less than that. And that's what these people are getting upset and angry about. But it always fits in with everything else that they do, because the right's entire shtick with all of this is their whole line about degeneracy and societal collapse. They're always pinning a scapegoat on somebody. And so this is their latest scapegoat that they found.
And I want to point out, too, because degeneracy is a word that I don't think most people connect to its root meaning. You break apart the word degenerate, and it's D and gene. Degenerate literally means against the race, against the genes. And so when they say something is degenerate, that's not just saying, oh, this is embarrassing to the culture. It's literally saying this is damaging to the gene pool.
Right, which is one reason why I really wish that people on the left would stop using this word, because I keep seeing a lot of people on the left use the word and not realize that this is what this word actually means. And part of that is just education. It literally is people just don't know what this word actually means. But you're right. It literally comes from the words down from or against, so de, and gens, which is a Latin word for tribe or for race. And so degenerate literally means against or down from one's race. So essentially, when you're calling something degenerate, you're saying that it's below your tribe or your race, or it's against it.
So on the federal level, an attempt to wipe them out of official existence is underway. The exact states that you would expect are also trying to wipe them out of existence in the name of the usual fiscal conservatism, which harkens back to the point that they're less than 1% of the U.S. population. So what money are you saving by denying them care?
Oh, you're talking in North Carolina. It's the state treasurer of North Carolina, and he's trying to push this policy under the name of fiscal conservatism, where he's essentially just denying transgender people of medical care. The interesting thing about this is that the insurance companies that provide North Carolina with the state health care are saying that this is a bad idea. They're saying that this is not supported by science, and by doing this, by denying people the right to proper medical care that is supported by science, is going to end up costing North Carolinians, that's correct, right? It's North Carolinians more.
I didn't even know state peoples got denominations like that.
Yeah, well, we do. Up in Oregon, we're an Oregonian, and you're probably an Arizonite. I don't know.
An Arizonite.
Arizonan. I don't know. But essentially, what's going on here is the state treasurer has decided that he knows better than all the insurance companies, all the medical professionals, and he's just going to deny these people coverage. And as of January 2018, the North Carolina health plan does not cover things like hormone replacement therapy, which is usually abbreviated as HRT.
You're talking about Medicaid.
Medicaid and like the state health plan for state workers and whatnot.
Oh, okay. So it's not just
that. Yeah. So that, and also anybody that's on the state government payroll, that kind of thing. So, and they of course also don't cover things like surgeries for a gender reassignment, which the state treasurer referred to as sex change operations, which is a technically incorrect term and one that is used to denigrate these kind of procedures.
It affects Medicaid and it affects state employees. But it does not outlaw the giving of care.
It doesn't ban the practice of these procedures, but what it does is it means that these procedures are off the table because they suddenly become unaffordable to people working for the state or people on the state health care plans through the marketplace that are funded in part by the North Carolina government, the state Medicaid program, that kind of thing. It's multiple different sources that's being cut off here. And it's,
as per usual, when the state declares war on a minority population, they usually end up just obliterating a whole bunch of people in the crossfire. Does this also affect people with like glandular problems that need HRT for non-trans reasons to get their thyroid, do whatever the hell a thyroid does, and now they can't get that care?
Well, that's part of the problem, right? Is that these medical procedures are then seen as, oh, this is the trans people procedure. You can't get this done. You have to find some other way of doing it. And so
AIDS is a gay disease.
Exactly. You run into those kind of problems. And that's where they're at right now in North Carolina because of these kind of attitudes. And this is all despite even the insurance company saying, hey, you're going to save a lot of money by actually listening to the medical professionals. And then the other part is, of course, is the social cost of people committing suicides, that kind of thing. Because the transgender community has one of the highest suicide rates out there, and it's because of how they're treated. It's not because they're transgender. It's because of how society treats them.
The state will always spend money to wage war on minorities. Fiscal conservatism goes out the window. Oh, you want the poor people want some? Oh, well, you need to be, you know, personal responsibility, but we're just going to waste it's probably billions of money eradicating trans people in the state of North Carolina. And they're not going to win. Yeah, a lot of trans people are going to lose. And you know what that means. But they're not going to win.
And I do want to preface this with the fact that Viagra is still something that you could purchase on a state healthcare plan. When it's erectile dysfunction, oh, they're cool with setting you up with that. No problem. But the transgender thing, suddenly they're not down with it. Some food for thought there. If you live in Massachusetts, there's an attempt to overturn Senate Bill 2407 of the state Senate, which prohibits discrimination based on gender identity in public spaces such as restrooms, hotels, stores, schools, locker rooms, that kind of thing. So make sure that you vote yes on Measure 3 to uphold the Senate bill, which protects those rights.
And to preface this, because the first thing that's going to be screamed by communists is voting doesn't matter. And I side with those people more often than I side with the people who say, oh, let's do everything through voting. Because honestly, you know, my state took away all of the ballot initiatives that the people actually wanted to vote for that would have given the teachers union their full victory, and one related to school funding. We got rid of those. But if it makes it through and the state doesn't decide to take it away from you, ballot measures are like the one time through a vote in a bourgeois democracy that you actually get to determine the shape of your society in even the littlest possible way. They're never going to let you vote by ballot measure to abolish capitalism. This is one of those things that the state is willing to concede ground on.
Well, the other thing is they're willing to concede ground on it because there's already a Senate measure in the Massachusetts chamber. So all this does is reaffirm and essentially automatically pass that particular bill. It will make it essentially just become law. It'll make it harder for them to overturn it come if they try to do that. And they probably will. Honestly, they probably will do that. but it will make it much harder for them to actually do it. So it is very important to vote on this particular issue to make sure that it gets passed through the ballot initiative, because it makes it that much harder for them to repeal it.
It's not a capitalism versus socialism issue. It's a do we bludgeon these people to death or no issue. Notice the big thing there is hotels and stores, places where people spend money. So elections are always going to let you decide which bourgeois to give your money to, or where it goes, or are these people allowed in this store or that store? And this is one of those times. So yes, this vote will actually do something. So it is, go ahead. Like the communists say, go ahead and vote for this. Never mind, the voting is useless, because in this time it is not.
And that isn't to say that there aren't times when voting is questionable in its usefulness. It's not to say that there isn't dirty play going on, because we have examples of massive fraud going on right now in our electoral system. Like in Georgia, for instance, right now in Georgia, the Secretary of State, Brian Kemp, is running for governor. And at the same time that he's running for governor as Secretary of State, he's engaging in a massive campaign to disenfranchise voters to a point that I've not seen in decades. Like, this is something that you would expect to hear like during the 60s, and it's happening today. Essentially, like, one of the latest things that he's done, he's blocked 53,000 voter registrations from the voting rolls. Essentially, what's going on here with this is that these voter registrations are in mostly Democratic communities. They're mostly African American. I would think it was like 70% of these registrations that were pulled were African Americans. Heavy blue districts, of course. And the reason that they were pulled, according to Brian Kemp, the Secretary of State, is because they went through their records and the names didn't match up, or the signatures didn't match up from what was signed on the form or printed on the form and what their driver's license said or what the Social Security Administration said. And essentially what they actually did was is they went through the records, and if it wasn't an exact match to the letter, including things like shortening of names or initializations, you know how some people initialize their middle name, or if there was a hyphen missing, they would just throw your registration out. It's not even that the registration forms were filled out wrong. They're just using this as a BS excuse to get rid of as many Democratic voters as possible so this guy can win this election.
Which should tell you the fact that this is happening in the South is worrying the hell out of them. I don't know much about the policies of the black woman running against him.
I do know a little bit about her history. So Stacey Abrams, which is her name, actually participated in a lot of various programs to get people to vote in Georgia, which is very interesting. Of course, this is happening now that that's going on. Brian Kemp has repeatedly accused her of voter fraud several times over the past decade. So this is not something that is just like a one-time thing with Kemp. So the thing that we actually, you do need to understand with Kemp is that he literally is the lowest of the low when it comes to these kind of things. Back in 2010, so about 8 years ago, there was a election in Quitman, Georgia, where they elected a majority of African Americans to the school board. And he ran an investigation after the election accusing the locals of committing election fraud. And he actually filed charges against somebody that helped their blind father fill out a ballot. And then he also pressed charges against other people who took the sealed ballots from the people's house to their mailbox and said that they were engaging in election fraud with no
proof. Something that if we do in Arizona too. Well, I did in the 2016 election before I became a communist. And I was scared to do that because I knew even then the party's not going to have my back if they decide to try to accuse me of fraud because I'm carrying a ballot to a box, which never actually happened.
Abrams, though, has been involved in a lot of activities to kind of counter this thing throughout Georgia. She's been really big in helping people get out and vote. One of the things that she's done is she sent out buses to actually get people get on the bus and then go vote. And there's been several times where these buses have actually been intercepted and the people have been told, no, you got to go home. You can't vote like this. But one of the other things about Georgia is that they do have the oldest computerized voting systems in the United States as well. So on top of all this election and voter suppression that's going on in Georgia, once you finally do get to the actual voting machines there that are computerized, they have these old Diebold machines, which is, it's the first company to make computerized election machines in the United States. These are machines.
Diebold is a military contractor, aren't they?
Yes, they are, or they do some military contracts. They're a security contractor, but they do other stuff. Their election machines are one of the things that they do.
This is why Bernie Sanders never brought up anti-war stuff.
So essentially what's going on here is they're using these machines that we don't know if they've been upgraded or updated or anything like that. And the assumption is not. It's proven that they're easily hacked. And there's multiple situations where people have actually hacked these things, went in there with an SD card and switched votes around, churned all the votes over, that kind of thing. And
oh my God, why do they have SD card slots?
Who knows? They're supposedly not connected to the internet, but somehow these machines somehow go down all at the same time in some instances. Who the heck knows what's going on with these machines? And then on top of that, they're flipping.
I should go with a Wi-Fi.
Yeah.
A Wi-Fi map app that like shows the strength of Wi-Fi signal. Should do that tomorrow. Just find a voting location, not even mine, and just go in and see if they're connected.
That would be very interesting to see if they are. I would imagine that they're probably not. They're probably connected through Ethernet cables, which in this case, it doesn't really matter how they're connected. It's the fact that they're connected to the internet. It is the problem. And with them being old machines like they are, running old operating systems, and they're closed source, so the bugs can't get fixed unless the company knows they exist. Those are all huge problems. And then on top of that, there's plenty of reports of the voting machines just outright flipping votes. And it should be, I should also just point out that when these machines were implemented back in 2000, 2002, when they started putting in these machines in more and more locations, as more machines were put in Georgia, Georgia went from being a blue state to a red state. And by 2004, Georgia was totally dominated by the Republican Party, whereas before, it was a swing state that voted blue.
They're doing the same thing in Texas, too. I mean, Texas should be considered a swing state, really, because it has two major cities that all vote Democrat.
Two major cities, and believe it or not, almost everybody in southern Texas along the border, that's heavy Democratic territory, and people fail to understand that. You always hear about all this concern along the border and everything, but the truth is that those voters along the border, heavy Democrats. So you have this whole section there that's blue. You have the urban areas, Houston, Austin, and Dallas, Fort Worth, that swing a little bit bluer as well. Texas would be a swing state if it weren't for some of these voting machines, more than likely. And the state is consistently getting slowly bluer as well, because more people are moving into Texas from other places. And not just,
Mexico. Play these games with the machines.
Exactly, which is why they're playing these games with the machines. And these machines are in 30% of the state counties, and they're the Hart eSlate machines, so they're not the Diebold machines. They're a tablet, and you just press the candidates. But what's going on here is apparently if you vote straight ticket on there, what's going on here with Democratic voters anyway, is if you don't wait for the system to put in all your votes, so they're blaming it on user error and they're saying it's a bug, and they're saying the bug doesn't happen if you wait. So they're saying wait and then confirm all your selections on the last page.
The bug doesn't happen if you never submit your vote.
Right, and the bug doesn't happen if you don't submit your vote. And of course, the bug doesn't seem to be happening if you're voting straight ticket Republican, which is interesting. You know, very interesting choice there on the side of the developers that they would create a bug that just consistently happens with the Democratic ballot choice.
So the conclusion here is that any state in which the majority of the election is done by machine, which excluding, ironically, Arizona, excluding Phoenix, which is the major population center, basically carries the vote for Arizona, because in Arizona, the elections are administered by county recorders, not the Secretary of State. So in Maricopa County in 2016, like one of the only good things that happened was a social Democrat was elected to the Maricopa County recorder, and he's basically gone to 90% vote by mail paper ballots.
And paper ballots is really how it should be done, because there is a paper trail to audit. And I'm not totally against the use of computers for this, but if we're going to use computers, we need to have receipts, and we need to have something that actually, like, it spits out something for the county recorders or whatever, and for the voters, that matches everything. And if there's any discrepancy, then there needs to be a paper recount of the votes to make sure. Also, perhaps maybe a second way of doing this would be, of course, just having a secondary machine that counts the paper things to make sure that the counts are all the same. And that would be a way of doing that. But then if you're going to do that, why not just do paper ballots in the first place? Because that defeats the whole point of having the computer count it. So
essentially, what this built up to is that the only conclusion to really reach from that is any state in which the majority of its election is done through a machine is an illegitimate election. And that's only going to be a matter of time until people realize that. I bet you Georgia's like already realized it.
Right, well,
and is hot on their feet about it.
I think,
but it's going to take a while for everyone else.
Yeah, and I really do think that if the Democrats lose in Georgia, they need to make a scene about it, because it's so obvious at this point. And I've seen like the polls and everything. If Abrams doesn't win the election, that's going to cause a lot of questions. And I really think that the thing that we really need to be saying over Twitter right now is hashtag Black Votes Matter. That's what we need to be getting out right now.
In the days following the election, if she loses, and something else should probably be created for Texas and all, just generally, like, that these elections through these machines are illegitimate because the machines are alienated from the people. There's no way to audit them. They're done by private companies that heavily favor Republicans, because Republicans invest government money into these companies' contracts more than Democrats do. I mean, Democrats do as well, but
we do need to remember, though, that it's not just the machines. You can still swing an election through cheating and also not cheating through the machines. Like, North Dakota is a perfect example of that, where right now North Dakota has limited the ability to vote if you have an ID that doesn't have a physical address on it. So what they're doing is they're saying if your ID has a P.O. box on it, you can't vote, which is interesting because North Dakota actually doesn't have voter registration. You show up to the polls with your ID and you vote. And you would think that would be enough to prove that you're a citizen of North Dakota and can fill out that ballot, and you should have every right to do so. Who this actually is affecting and who they're targeting is mostly people on Native American reservations who have the right to vote, but because the post office doesn't deliver to a lot of places on reservation, these people don't have physical mailing addresses and therefore have to get a P.O. box to have their ID sent to them. And that's what the state registers them under. And then, of course, the state now wants to go around and turn around on them and say, well, you can't vote. Even though it's the state's decision and in part the federal government's decision to refuse them a physical address so that they can do so. So this is a catch-22 for Native Americans. And interestingly enough, this particular restriction was very calculated, because if you run the math on the numbers, Heidi Kemp, which is the current governor, won the governorship by 3,000 votes in a state that has, and the state only has like 770,000 people in the state or so. And so this particular change swings the election, because it turns out that if you run the numbers and everything with the amount of people who live on reservations, calculate in the ratio of Democrats in there, the ratio of Democrats who vote, which is also important, and then all of a sudden you realize, oh, they swung the election by between 4,000 and 6,000 votes, and that's well enough more needed to cost Heitkamp the election.
So as socialists are rallying, Craig going forward needs to be that these elections are illegitimate, period.
If she loses this election, the election's essentially illegitimate. The GOP cheated. The GOP manipulated the numbers of who can vote so that...
beyond the normal limits of what is usually acceptable cheating.
Exactly, and this is
within bourgeois democracy.
This is unprecedented.
This is tin pot post-Soviet.
Exactly, this is
installed dictator level.
This is what we criticize other countries of doing, and here we are doing it. Like I said, with Georgia, in the case of them, this is on top of all the other BS that they're already doing. Like, they've already closed down places in Georgia because of the ADA restrictions, even though these places were registered and had exceptions. The GOP complained and had polling places shut down in Democratic areas. Not just in Georgia, they did it in Illinois, they did it in Arizona, I believe, on a Native American reservation, too. They use the same ADA process to shut it down, and they don't care about disabled people. They don't care about disabled people one bit. And here they are, bad faithing it up like they always do.
So it's an all-out attempt at massive fraud, and no one's talking about it but us and like the Democratic voters. I've always maintained there's a big difference between the Democratic Party and Democratic voters. The Democratic Party isn't really a party, because it doesn't really represent or include or involve its people very much.
When we talk about Democratic Party and Republican Party, the Republican Party, actually it was the Democratic Party a while back, kind of gave this explanation as to what the parties actually really were. And essentially, I remember hearing a few years back, and I don't know who said it, but I remember it was a Democrat. They essentially said that the parties were private clubs. And let that sit in for a second. These guys, Republicans, Democrats, whatever. It's not about some overarching ideology or anything that they're motivated by. They're private clubs. They're private clubs so that rich people can maintain power. And you got the conservative party on the right, which is the Republicans. And then you have the liberal party on the so-called left that opposes it. At the end of the day, it's like some bizarre alien versus predator pornography where they're just both gonna fuck you.
But the point is that Republicans go all in on it because, for the most part, people who vote Republican are either wrapped up in white identity or they're property owners. For the most part, people who vote for Democrats are working people who don't understand like what a political party is. The political party is a group of people, normal everyday people, who are pushing forward a political agenda that is essentially self-advocacy. In 2016, they started to realize that the Democratic Party doesn't actually like do any of that. But
I think they've realized this a long time. This is why I believe it was like half of Democratic voters I've read don't actually vote. They don't care. They feel left out. It's only the Democratic Party's fault. They only have themselves to blame for the policies that they push, because they don't talk about workers' issues. They've marginalized the working class. They've put them in a box, and they've said, we're going to listen to our donors, the private club, before we listen to you. And so that means that a lot of people have been left out of the political process, and now they don't feel encouraged to participate, which means that the biggest block of voters out there that consistently vote are now Republican.
And those Democratic voters who are constantly forced to this false dichotomy, so now when they're being threatened with their lives, they're going and voting Democrat, and they're trying, knowing that this is not the best of all possible worlds, but it's the only two choices that we have. Well, when that election gets stolen from them, when they already don't get to vote for the thing they really don't actually really want to vote for, period, that's our end. That is our moment.
Exactly. And see, here's the thing. And I'm all for voting. Go out and vote. But here's the thing. Do that on November 6th. But on November 7th, be out there organizing. You organize the rest of the year. But go out and vote. It takes 2 seconds to fill out a ballot or whatever. Just go out there. Do it. It's not going to harm anything. And for all those people to say, oh, well, I'm legitimizing a system. Well,
it's gonna beat you over the head with a club whether you vote or not. It's a really silly issue, because if it's so meaningless, then doing it or not doing it and taking those 5 minutes or 10 minutes or whatever isn't really a loss, and it's a bunch of wasted paper, wasted breath, and wasted time to argue about its finer points. So, like, November 7th, regardless of whatever the issue is, go out in the middle of the night and pin "We should form a tenants union" on every damn door of your apartment complex. As you're checking out, hand IWW info to the person who's checking you out. That's where we begin. And in the larger national conversation, it's that these elections are illegitimate. So start getting with us being socialists. No one party, not CPUSA, not DSA, not whatever. Just the general idea of the left, because we actually have answers. And we'll say the things that you wish the Democratic Party would. And if we have power, we'll do the things you actually wish the Democratic Party would.
Well, that, and politics can't fix everything. Sometimes you have to go outside of politics to get stuff done, which is what things like unions are for. So,
for the most part, politics exists to make sure nothing gets done.
Exactly. In many ways, if you really think about it, that kind of is the point of our Constitution in many ways. Our Constitution wasn't meant for creating progress in a fast manner. It was actually created to ensure that policies go through in a fairly slow manner. It wasn't designed for efficiency.
So it's not just here that the lying and the cheating and the rigging and the fraud is happening. Like, property globally is showing its teeth. And as I've always said amongst my friends, Brazil is really important. Look at Brazil. It's one of the important places that socialism has to happen in, or can happen in, for it to really matter. Rojava is great, but it can't project power. You get a place like Brazil and you can take an entire continent. And the bourgeoisie know that, which is why they've implanted a fascist into that country for property to show its teeth. And with the election of Bolsonaro, who says the things that Trump wishes he could say, and will probably do the things that Trump wishes he could do. On the election night, there was already an outbreak of violence that we didn't see in this country. Like, the fascists in Brazil just outright decided, okay, it's time to go burn down indigenous neighborhoods, which is exactly the kind of thing that they did. And instantly, like, we were inundated with a flood of panicked Brazilian leftists who I watched go step by step through the same process we went in 2016 of thinking it wasn't going to happen and trying to get people to go and vote for the lesser of two evils. And then when that didn't work, not knowing what the heck to do and being in this period of complete confounded terror. And for a lot of people, the first thing was to flee.
That whole situation was just, it was like watching a train wreck in slow motion, because I knew when Jair Bolsonaro won the, I don't think it was called a primary, but it was like the first round of elections. When he
won, it was
won
a foregone
that,
conclusion.
Yeah, when I saw those numbers, like, I realized that it was a foregone conclusion. There's no way mathematically that this is going to break down, and we need to begin the process for emergency preparation in regards to addressing this situation. of course, you know, the thing that everybody knew was going to happen and didn't want to happen happened. The response, though, that did come from the left around the world was actually really great. Two very, very close friends of mine online, FiberSynth and Dark Moonpaw, which are, of course, furries, if you can't tell by their names, and FiberSynth has been on the show, got together with a bunch of other leftists, some furries, some not, on Telegram, and actually created a community for organizing Brazilian leftists to find out what their needs are and help them out. And essentially, we've just been listening to what's been going on, the news coming out of there, getting to know these people, and even help them out, like, financially with things. We've been talking about help raising money for people.
Their first response, as my first response when Trump was elected, was I packed back, not even knowing in the back of my mind, I wasn't going anywhere. There wasn't anywhere to go to. Which, by the way, if this is happening in your country, or has already happened in your country, which is most likely the U.S., because that's who listens to us. There's no running from this. The takeaway from Brazil should be that anywhere there is property interests, this will happen. And there's no running from this. And that the first thing that people that I encountered from Brazil were thinking of doing was fleeing, getting out of the country. And a lot of other leftists were organizing around that thought of how can we help them leave the country. But
okay, well, see, this is a natural biological response. This is fight or flight. But the reality is, there's no flight. There's nowhere right to go. Property interests and capitalism rules everywhere, except for just a few isolated spots in the world, like Rojava. But for the most part, there's nowhere to go. And for a lot of these people, even if they could go, like, even if they could go to, like, Europe or whatever, where it wouldn't be as bad, and, you know, social conditions are totally different.
Well, even across the border right from Brazil, Uruguay, things are a lot better for people, and that's kind of where everyone thinks, oh, we're going to go to Uruguay. But running away like that is a much more... As someone who's lost everything, who's been evicted, who's been on the street, like, having to do that is a much more disorientating and demoralizing experience than most people think. It's not just grabbing a bag and going. Your entire life changes. And the thing that I think should be done more for Brazil by international leftists is we need to do what so-called communist countries like China should be doing, which is assisting the global left.
Like who?
I think setting up.
Wait a second. Like who? You probably cut out below the noise floor. So who should be?
Do I have to say
up?
It? Yeah. Everyone should know. You make me say China. You see Xi Jinping. Like I've always complained about.
China recently
world superpower aiding leftists.
Well, China recently said that they were gonna help defend the world from the United States, and I don't really see them doing that right now.
That was a headline in a news piece that didn't actually appear anywhere in the Chinese source material. The source material from China was really more like, we need to protect our interests, and that probably means defeating the United States.
Oh, shit. So you're just telling me that I fell for some right-wing propaganda bullshit, for some nationalist...
No, it wasn't right-wing propaganda. It was innocent. It was NBC or MSNBC or whichever, one of the BCs. No, it wasn't right-wing propaganda. It's just, it was a clickbait title.
Why legitimate news
though, right?
Legitimate news organizations, will you please stop it with the clickbait titles?
Legitimate news agencies aren't reporting on anything important. Are they reporting on the story? Like, if our news counted for anything, the big story would be voting machines all over the country suck and shouldn't be trusted. That would be the news story. But no, that's not the news story.
Well, according to Fox News...
24-hour coverage of the stupid caravan.
According to Fox News, the biggest problem in the United States is in southern Mexico, slowly trekking up the border, and somehow they're going to arrive tomorrow at the border and all vote Democrat. All 4,000 to 8,000. Well, they keep raising the number on Fox News. Like, at first I saw it was 4,000 and 6,000 and 8,000. I wouldn't be surprised if I woke up tomorrow and I get a notification on my phone from like a Fox News story that gets promoted through Google, because why not promote their stuff? Google is saying that like a million a caravan all voting Democrat in Texas and they flipped it, you know.
Speaking of Google, 17,000 people from Google went on what was essentially a strike, but not called a strike. 17,000 Google workers walked out of their facilities in response to the company doing practically nothing about its tech bro parading and praising of sexual harassment.
Well, it's because when they fired Andy Rubin, they gave him like a fat freaking severance pay check for leaving the company, essentially. That was the guy that invented Android, and it just also turns out that he's a whole bag of dicks too, unfortunately. It's always how it ends up with these tech bros. It is interesting that they're calling it a walkout, not a strike. They need... I really wish that the workers in this case would kind of, you know, pardon the language, but nut up and just call it a strike.
But the fact that they're doing it at Google...
Yeah, the fact that
I remember a month ago, one of the conversations you and me were having with friends was how to spread socialism within the tech culture. And the conclusion was, well, it's impossible. The tech culture is just completely concluded. You're just made up of tech bros and they absolutely own it. There's nothing. Those people will never radicalize. It's too dangerous for them. And what happens less than a month later? And that's like what I was saying in the beginning about how none of this stuff should discourage us, because at the same time, what's not reported that you have to read in between the lines to see is that as all this stuff is happening, our predictions of who will do what is proven wrong in the best way possible.
Exactly. Constantly. We got proven wrong in the best way possible, that people went out and they actually organized, and who would have thought? And that really just goes to show that organizing is not impossible. You just have to be willing to put yourself on the line to actually do it. You have to be willing to speak up, because if you're not willing to do it, then nobody else is. Somebody has to make that first move. Getting back to this whole immigration caravan. So, like I said, the numbers keep going up on the news reporting. It's ridiculous. Fox News is spreading the panic like they've never spread it before. They have guests on claiming things like these people have leprosy or they have smallpox or whatever disease. And it, of course, there's only been 3 cases of leprosy, by the way, in that Central America area. And there's been exactly 0 cases of smallpox in the wild since 1978. Smallpox has been eradicated for years, decades.
If the Republicans' arms all fall off, they can't vote.
No, that's not smallpox. Oh, that's leprosy that you're making it.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Jeez. Well, there's that. And then the other one, as they were claiming, was tuberculosis. And then the lie there is that tuberculosis rates in Central America are just only slightly higher than they are in the United States, which is practically non-existent in the United States and extremely rare in South America and Central America. So all of this
it's all calling forth of the brain aid of the horrible pestilence and plague bringing foreigner that doesn't actually exist outside of the fascist brain.
It's trying to conjure up in these people's minds this image of, and I hate to use this term, but this is the term that the Nazis like to use, is they like to call people vermin and compare people to rats and make the connotation that they spread disease. This is something that the right does on a regular basis, and not just even the Nazis. We see this in American culture with Native Americans and how they're treated, with Hispanics. Of course, that's what this whole caravan thing's about. Also with, I used to hear it all the time growing up in the South with Black people, that Black people are diseased people and dirty and you don't want to hang out with them. And, you know, like their hair's that way because, you know, they don't wash them, you know, all sorts of just bullshit stuff. Like, no, I am serious. That's the kind of stuff that I used to hear growing up.
When I was growing up, I thought it was the opposite, because I thought, like, the do-rags that they wear were literally shower caps.
Man, you're going to make everybody hate us, and, well, I've already done that. Okay. So. And then the response, like, the government response to all this was, oh, the U.S. is going to send 5,200 troops to the border, right?
And is that so, what it's at now? That number, too, keeps growing.
Yeah, it's this number. Okay, so this number keeps growing, too, but also there's a lot of misreporting going on as well. So there's already troops stationed at the border, but they're mostly National Guard. Let's just ignore numbers for a second. Let's ignore numbers of how many troops are being sent. Just look at the hypothetical situation. The president is sending active military to the border. Now, this is a violation of posse comitatus, but the reason that President Trump and his administration can get away with doing this is because of the language that is being used to describe the caravan. And this is why every time that you hear the caravan being referred to by Trump and people in his administration, they always use the term invasion, because under an invasion, according to the United States Constitution, you can do several things you can't normally do. And one is suspend posse comitatus, which is the stationing of active military on U.S. soil. And then the second thing that they can do is suspend habeas corpus, which is where if you are accused of a crime, you should get due process. And there's a couple different amendments of the Constitution, including the Fifth Amendment, that goes along with this. And one of those rights is this idea that if the government accuses you of something, they have to have evidence and must try you with that evidence in a court of law. That is what habeas corpus is. So what they can actually do now in these areas where these troops are stationed, he can suspend habeas corpus and say, you're under arrest, this is the charge, but they don't actually have to provide the evidence and try you in court. So essentially, you could be detained and accused of something. You could be accused of something and detained, and that's it.
So the two possibilities derived from this are A, it's midterms posturing bullshit, or B, they've already made it a foregone conclusion they're going to win the midterms because they've rigged the elections. And then they're just going to, once a caravan arrives, do the dictatorship, which I think likely.
Yeah, so essentially what I think they're going to try to do, based off of the rhetoric, I don't think that the Trump administration cares too much about optics, given everything that they have said and how reviled they are anyway. The Trump administration has hinted at, well, not even hinted, they flat out said that, hey, if anybody throws rocks at the soldiers, that's a firearm and we're going to kill people for that. So I don't think this is all talk. I really think that this is what they're going to do. This is the same administration that has thrown children into concentration camps, and that's exactly what they are. So
no, the clarification is that it doesn't suspend the two important Latin things nationwide.
Yeah, so it's within the area that essentially martial law is declared in. And that's exactly what this is. This is martial law. And the funny thing about all this is that if anybody has any political memory, if you've grown up during the Clinton years or the Bush years or even under Obama, there were multiple times in which the president activated National Guard and sent them down towards the border. And These people that are all screaming and cheering on the troops right now were screaming and complaining that Clinton, Bush, or Obama was declaring martial law and putting the, you know, and going to crack down on the entire country and run over their rights and all this and that. And it was going to be the end of America. But Trump does it. A-okay, cheer the guy on. The thing is like, gosh, if that's not just projection, but we also see that a lot of times these projections tend to creep out in the actions of right wingers such as Trump. And this might actually be a test to see what they get away with. And that, in my mind, that's exactly what this is that this is. This is the Trump administration trying to see what they can get away with, how much they can up the ante, and what limits they can push. And so if they can get away with sending the troops to the border, they will. If they can get away with killing some people across the border, they're going to do that.
And I think that they will, right? Because that border is not very populated.
So I mean,
the closest city is like San Diego and Tucson, which are cities.
Actually, it would be closer and faster probably for them to come up through southern Texas, because the border is
less sparse.
Yeah, so the border is kind of like diagonally sloped, with South Texas being the closest point to the Yucatan, and from where these people are would cross over. So that's probably where they're going to send it. I mean, they may go west because it might be easier to do that. I don't know the routes because I've not made that trek before. So, you know, who knows? Maybe they may go that way. But in terms of what this is and what it looks like to me, is it seems very obvious to me that this is them testing the waters to see what they can do. This may be the predilection to a martial law during an election time. Not maybe this election time, but maybe this is preparation for 2020. And that's a scary thought in and of itself.
If it were that, and like I said, I think they will get away with it because it's such a sparsely populated area. The way elections are, they'd have to try this in populated cities. And it would have to be a lot of important, very large cities. It's easy to swallow up what happens on the border. Customs and Borders Patrol does it daily, swallows up their crimes into oblivion, and no one ever hears about it. But if you were to try to do this in, like, L.A., those troops wouldn't even be able to occupy the street. Where would they quarter them? The people would rebel. Of that, I'm certain even liberals would just rebel over. Like, that would even get them outside. To do this with cities versus sparsely populated ranch land at the border are two completely different.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of logistics. But the other end of this has sparked a lot of conspiracy theories among the right as well, including a lot of people accusing George Soros of somehow funding the caravan, and all these like bizarre theories about how this is like the Jews' fault. It's gone absolutely off the rails. And this is actually what prompted, in part, the MAGA bomber, for instance. Like, he was inspired in part by this caravan. Also, the synagogue shooter, the guy that went into the Pittsburgh synagogue and killed up 11 people. He too was inspired by this particular event. And that was the largest killing of American Jews in United States history, at least on our soil. In addition to that, there was a shooting in Louisville where a guy shot a person in a Kroger and then in the parking lot. And then when he was approached by another guy with a gun, he looked the guy in the eye and said, don't shoot me, bro. Whites don't kill whites. And he too, as well, when authorities went over his like Facebook and all of that, turns out same kind of story going on, same kind of conspiracy theories. And then there was an attempted school attack that also happened in Kentucky as well, where the police, the odd story about this one is that this guy posted on Facebook a threat to a woman in New Jersey, and she called the authorities in Kentucky on this guy because she found out where he lived. And right as the guy was leaving out of his driveway to shoot up some school in Kentucky, the police caught him backing out of his driveway. And then, to top it all off, shooting number five here, or a terrorist attack number five, in my hometown in Tallahassee, Florida, some guy shoots two women in a yoga class.
And do you think that, like, when the police roll up on these, they're like, oh, damn it, we have to do our job and, like, get this guy in trouble? Why couldn't he have gotten away with it?
I don't think all cops think that, but, like, yeah, I think as far as, like, a lot of, like, the white supremacist kind of stuff, there's no doubt that a lot of cops empathize with that kind of thing. A lot of them are like, oh, God, not again. Why is it always us? And then, like, there is probably that segment. But in terms of that kind of thought, I don't really think that that's even helpful, because the fact is, I mean, they're not allies of the working class. They're not out there to help us. They're out there to protect and serve the wealthy. And they have no legal obligation to actually help you. So if you call the cops because you're being assaulted, one, they don't have a responsibility to show up and break up the crime while it's in progress. They could sit back and watch and let it happen. And they're legally entitled to do so because their lives might be at risk. That's actually a Supreme Court case that ruled that. And then the second part is let's say they did. Let's say that they did, and that was a dereliction of duty to even do that. Most of the time, the crime's already done and over with by the time the police show up anyway. So the question is what does any of that matter? If 9 times out of 10, the crime's already been done, what are the police going to do about it?
And this is where you get the whole right-wing gun culture from, because, like, they, on an instinctual level, know this. It's just they arm themselves, you know, for when the poor are gonna come after them because they're white or some weird stuff. Like, right-wingers' politics, in terms of the anti-government stuff, the arms-bearing stuff, tends to check out. It's just segued in the completely wrong direction, which is done on purpose.
Yeah, it's a whole perversion of ideology and everything in it. It is there to suit the rights of the propertied and the moneyed class. That's what it's designed to do. And so everything is kind of within that expression. And it's a perversion to things like real gun rights for working class people, real gun rights for minorities, which always get the stick when it comes to gun rights, because every time African Americans start arming themselves, suddenly that's the problem. That's when the NRA starts passing gun laws or getting lobbying to pass gun laws. I mean, that's the truth. These people, they don't care about the gun rights and stuff like that. It's just they're in a position of power and they want to keep their position of power, and that's how they perpetuate it. But looking at just all of the stepping back and looking at all of these five incidents and everything that they have in common, you know, the white supremacy element of it, the incel element of it, to the Tallahassee shooting, just the fact that almost all the shooters showed violent rhetoric towards Jewish people, towards journalists, like the MAGA bomber, he threatened people on Twitter. He threatened numerous people on Twitter, and they reported him. The same thing happened with the synagogue shooter, that he was reported. The guy that shot up the yoga class threatened women on Twitter. And
all of us are afraid. All of us leftists are afraid. Right? Oh, man, Facebook and the FBI, they're going to see what I'm doing, and we got to encrypt all of our shit. When, like, the FBI get tips of all these people, don't do anything anyway.
Well, the other thing is like, in terms of FBI, let's hypothetically say if you saw something that you thought was worthy of reporting to the FBI for whatever reason, if the FBI's Twitter page literally says, do not at them to report stuff, to call their number, or to or to get a hold of them through one of their official channels. So adding the FBI or retweet at FBI is not a report, and they're not going to take it seriously. Now, in terms of Twitter reports, though, Twitter ignored this, which not surprising, but still, the fact that Twitter received hundreds of reports from about the MAGA bomber, but also about the synagogue shooter and other shooters, just goes to show that they're not taking this issue serious.
Right. And they won't, because crime isn't to be, it's just to be sorted out. It is just to be sorted out afterwards.
Well, that, and also like, the tech bros that run Twitter and run Facebook, etc., they're complicit in all of this propaganda and spreading it. In the name of course, they claim
they'll be at Nuremberg.
Yeah, sure. They claim that it's to enhance debate. And some of the just BS that I've just heard within the last week of like recent changes to Twitter is, we're going to get rid of the like button because it's not healthy for discourse. Why not get rid of commenting on the retweet comment thing where you can quote a tweet, because that derails conversations more than anything, because all that's used for is, hey, look at the smackdown that I just did or whatever. And it's not even helpful to debate. But no, the problem's clearly the like button, not the tool that TERFs on Twitter use to harass trans people, or that any general everyday milquetoast fascist of whatever sort uses to dogpile anybody they deem leftist.
So like the most hilarious thing about that is that they want to take away the like feature because, like, you know, there's some like trans rights or human rights meme or something goes wrong, gets a bunch of likes. Well, they get rid of the like feature, everyone's just going to retweet that. It's going to spread even more.
Because with the likes, like, you may see a notification on your Twitter of, your four bros that you always interact with on Twitter like this, so you'll like this too. But if they retweet it, it actually has a much higher effect. And that's also why they kind of got rid of chronological timelines as well and did curated, is so that they can kind of curate out certain retweets based on an algorithm. And to get back to the discussion here, I mean, it's quite obvious that the social media websites, the major ones, are engaging in this propaganda campaign in correspondence with the right. If you look at who Jack follows on Twitter, it becomes obvious. If you look at who he communicates with on Twitter, it becomes obvious. And so
they seem to be doing a good job of it, considering like the left is still spreading. Not even a month ago, when I go to certain places on Reddit, like outside of the leftist sphere on Reddit, and see any kind of post, I was always the one to make the post, actually, you're wrong, capitalism is a problem, shut up, stupid. Now I go and it's like someone's already beat me to the punch. So they're not really doing a good job.
Yeah, well, it's because they're more and more, they're getting dogpiled with responses. The left is also slowly growing as well, so there's that. So they're having a hard time keeping
more
all
like
this
exponentially
stuff.
Growing.
Yeah, well, they're having a hard time keeping all of this under the rug. It's becoming more and more of a challenge, and so that's why they're trying to come up with all of these ways, you know, all these more creative ways in which they think that they could just suppress us. But like you said, I mean, when it comes down to it, Nuremberg 2.0, Jack's going to be high on the list of people that are getting tried. Definitely these people. And then, of course, we have sites like Gab, for instance, that are just like full-on right-wing propaganda sites masking as social media networks as well, which is actually where a couple of these terrorists, and that's exactly what they are, radicalize themselves. They radicalize themselves through Gab, through 4chan. Those were the circles that they hung out with online. And I think if there's any parents out there listening, if you see your kids interacting on the Chans or interacting on Gab, you know, look for that clover leaf icon, look for that the frog icon, get yourself familiar with some of these icons and what they are. And if you see them on their phone, you need to have a conversation with your kid because they could be interacting with some dangerous people. A lot of parents have lost their kids to this kind of thing.
Yeah, and they don't know. So much for all that helicopter parent culture, right?
I always got the impression that really wasn't about the well-being of children as so much as I just want my child to succeed, so I'm just going to pressure the teacher into giving them A's, even though that doesn't actually make your child succeed, and that actually is a detriment in the long run to your child's well-being. All they're really doing is just inflating their mediocre child's grade, and it's not going to translate into any like real world experience. I mean, if they suck at math, they suck at math, and they need to pursue something else perhaps, and they perhaps college isn't their thing, and they just need
Yeah. Standardized testing means you can't suck at math or
so here's the thing about that. There's no shame in going to a vo-tech school, and parents need to understand this. You know, if your kid isn't good at math or isn't good at English and can't get into a college, but maybe he can do, you know, the basic level stuff and slowly learn it up. Maybe becoming somebody that repairs air conditioners or becomes a plumber or becomes an electrician. Maybe that's good for that person. Maybe that's what their role is. And they would never know otherwise if they just got shoehorned into a college education. I'm not saying college education is bad. It's great, but...
It's a detriment to force.
Yeah, and that's part of this whole, like, demonizing of working culture that, like, we see across our society. And that's kind of part of it is, you know, the whole everybody needs to go to college meme.
And Trump demonized it recently, too. Just the attack on the worker never stops. So this weird, weird thing about socialism, which read social democracy, not actually socialism. And the White House put out this thing that the opportunity costs of socialism.
That thing.
Well-worded propaganda already concluding that, you know, socialism is going to cost you opportunity, whatever that is. Opportunity to what? To work for a wage like any other anything?
Yeah, okay. And the study was heavily flawed because, like, the whole study just kind of convoluted all the different types of socialism within the, like, how, like, right-wingers perceive socialism, right? So it did, like, typify things, but then it kind of also started blurring the lines, and it was a really confusing report in and of itself. But
it was so out of left field too. Like, someone in some department got scared of us.
No, it was Donald Trump. He's had this bug up his butt for at least a month now, ever since he started getting worried about the elections, and he started seeing the trend of social Democrats coming in. He's kind of been afraid about those midterms. And essentially what's going on here is that Trump earlier last month, like towards the beginning of the month, created this whole editorial. It was freaking bizarre about like how the Democrats were going after senior citizens' health care and wanted to eliminate Medicaid. And it was weird. Every part of it was a lie. And yet USA Today, which was the paper that allowed this to be published, went with it, allowed him this platform to spew provable falsehoods.
I really wish we could make defending journalism like form. I really wish we could make defending journalism a platform of the left. Like, I wish journalism was under attack. Right, and like that could be one of the other things that kind of shit happens.
So, journalism is under attack by the right. Like, make no mistake about it. All these people that we talked about earlier, the MAGA bomber, the synagogue shooter, all those people were influenced by this idea that the press is lying to them. They were influenced by Trump going out there and saying it's the lying press, and also Trump going out there and essentially saying things like somebody should do something about that, you know, kind of language, which essentially, like, that is a type of terrorism, by the way. When political pundits go out there and say things to provoke people into violence, that is a form of terrorism. It's called stochastic terrorism. And that's essentially what we've been presented with within the last 2 weeks here.
And to buffer my point of, like, don't be discouraged and depressed and all this because of what's going on. Because they're at this point, because we've spent the past 2 years clearing them off of every street in which they try to assemble. The fascist state needs its non-uniformed thuggery in order to carry out violence that the state can then claim plausible deniability of never having actually done.
I wanted to round back to the first topic
of the trans rights, because for some reason this is still an issue on the left, and there are some leftists, Jason, who make this their sticking point. Like, for some reason trans people don't matter. And even if you don't like trans people, even if you don't think they're really a man or don't think they're really a woman, or even if for whatever reason you just think they're weird because, like, as they first transition, it's like uncanny valley or whatever your reason is for quote, not liking trans people, you must defend them because you are defending yourself. The first easiest target a regime can pick at, can destroy with the passive acceptance of the population, even if that target is ridiculously minuscule, like trans people, less than 1% of the U.S. population.
Yeah,
it's ridiculously minuscule. The minute they can do that,
it's that whole line of, like, first they came for the Jews.
Yeah,
and
opening fire on you.
This is exactly what they're doing on the right. They're partitioning people up for the purpose of eliminating them or removing their power. So that's...
It is within your interest. If you just want to be plain old damn selfish, it is within socialism's interest. If you will give everything to socialism, but for some reason still don't like trans people, it's in every interest of yours, if you are not a fascist, to support trans people. You can continue to think the rest of your life that they're not really men or not really women.
Yeah, but you can. So you're saying you could continue to be wrong, but yeah. So exactly, like, these people, they can continue to be wrong. They can continue to do this. But the only people that these people on the left that choose to go this route are doing is hurting themselves and marginalizing other people. That's all they're doing at this point. And people like Jason Unruh essentially are just dividing up the left for marketability to people that don't care about leftism, essentially. And this isn't how we convert people over to leftism. You're not going to
listen to Jason Unruh because he doesn't like trans people.
Yeah, exactly. This isn't going to convert people over to the left by saying, oh, we hate those people too, don't worry. Oh, you could still be a leftist and not like these. No, no. See, that's not how you win people over. And you're not going to slowly convert those opinions over time using those kind of means. The only thing you're going to do is drag already toxic people into leftist spaces who then are going to pollute those spaces and knock LGBT people out of those spaces. That's what's going to happen.
And then what are our politics? Like, then we're denied from the politics that most naturally benefits us. Now, I mean, the fascists already kind of set up a fall for that. Like, there's a reason why fascists are going easy on the gay is a natural sin line this time around, because they can tie it in with masculinity and use it to drive a wedge between masculine bro gay men and trans people by making those gay men think that trans people are somehow coming after their masculinity. After they've done that, they don't give a crap. It's gassy like the rest of them. So you have to stand with trans people, yeah, regardless of whatever you think about them.
And it's a trap. That's exactly what it should be seen as, and not in the slang sense of the word, which is gross. But This is a trap that fascists have created so that they can boost their numbers by looking like they support something that they don't actually support. And it's really dangerous. And we shouldn't counter that on the left with exclusionary politics. And so people like Jason Unruh or whatever need to start realizing that what they're doing isn't helping the left. Like we say every week here, because we're wrapping up here for tonight, if you like our show, give us a like, comment, subscribe, all that fun stuff on SoundCloud there. So just show us some SoundCloud love. Show us some YouTube love if you're on YouTube. And if you want to interact with us, I am at Kitsune Flame on Twitter, and Hims, you are?
I'm at Hims Fox.
At Hims Fox. And then the network is at Enceladus1 on Twitter. And then I also have a Mastodon account that is just KitsuneFlame at Mastodon.social if you want to do that instead and not support the big social media companies.
With your wallet. No, I'm just kidding.
No. Ethical consumption under capitalism. Okay. Good night, everybody. And bye.
Good night.